Welcome back. The court-appointed Special Advocates of New York City is a not-for-profit organization that's providing one-on-one advocacy to help children and youth in New York City's foster care grow up in safe, permanent, as well as loving homes where they can thrive. CASA NYC plays a crucial role in assisting New York's overburdened family court system meet the needs of one of the city's most vulnerable populations. Now, for many abused children, a dedicated CASA NYC advocate may be the one constant presence in their life, even the only adult who actually cares for them. And joining us now to share a little bit more about the details is the executive director of the court-appointed Special Advocates of New York City, Kerry Moles. And Kerry, good to have you with us.
Thanks for having me, Darren.
Glad to have you sharing. And Kerry, share with us a little bit about this here, because when we talk about court-appointed special advocates, let's talk about what is a court-appointed special advocate.
Sure. A court-appointed special advocate is a volunteer, typically. At CASA NYC, we have about 300 volunteers. They come from all walks of life, New York City residents, and they are trained. They go through a 35-hour training process, and they're supervised by social workers and attorneys and other master's level mental health counselors who are on our staff. And their job is essentially to work one-on-one with a young person, a child or a young adult who's in foster care, to help them navigate the foster care system, to make sure that their needs are being met while they're in the system. And really, our mission is to help get them out of the foster care system as quickly as possible, because we know that foster care is really not a good situation for anyone, and kids are best do best when they're at home with their parents or with other people who love them and care for them.
Yeah. And share with us a little bit about how it's actually been impacted by COVID, because when you have a foster care system that relies heavily on interaction, let's talk about how this virtual has impacted the work that you do.
Sure. Well, so when the courts shut down in March, they shut their doors physically in March. The family courts obviously did everything they could to pivot to a virtual format really quickly, but that was challenging. And so what it meant initially was that for a long time, the courts were only hearing emergency cases. So that was typically a child where there was a new allegation of abuse or neglect, and there was a question of whether that child needed to be removed from their home. And the other cases, the more routine cases, which are really, I say routine, but they're very important cases, got adjourned. And so there has been, while the courts took several months, they were only hearing emergency cases. They have started to hear other cases, non-emergency cases, but there's obviously a huge backlog. And what's happened is that kids, for one thing, kids who have been in foster care have gotten stuck there for longer than they probably would have been otherwise. When a child might have been scheduled to be reunified with a parent or be adopted or moved to live with an aunt in New Jersey, those hearings didn't happen. So those kids remained in foster care. And also, you know, having not had, for when judges are not able to have these cases in front of them, it makes it much more difficult for judges to hold the agencies accountable and to make sure that the kids are really getting their needs met while they're in foster care. So we have a lot of concerns about the ability of, you know, the agencies in the foster care system in general to make sure that kids' needs are being met and their parents' needs are being met during this pandemic.
Yeah, adoption is a major thing that goes on frequently, but talk to us about how adoption cases are being handled, given the fact that we are where we are today with this pandemic.
Sure. I mean, I think it's, you know, again, when a child is in foster care, and I'm really speaking about the foster care system as opposed to private adoptions, but when a child is in foster care, once they have been freed for adoption, you know, there's a legal process and it takes some time. And in many cases, those hearings for adoption have been adjourned. So I know that in 2020, for the 10 months that we have information on, we've seen a great decline in the numbers of kids who've been adopted, as well as the number of kids who've been reunified with their parents. The process is just taking a lot longer. Hopefully those, you know, adoptive parents aren't going away, but every day or year that a child remains in foster care, as opposed to being in a permanent home, that can have long-term impacts on that child's development.
Yeah. There have been a lot of myths and stereotypes that have always been associated, excuse me, when it comes to foster care. Share with us a little bit about some of those myths and those stereotypes, and if we could try to debunk a couple of those now.
Sure. I mean, I think the most important thing and the biggest stereotype is the idea that children in foster care have always been abused and that their parents have abused them, and that's why they're in foster care. The vast majority of the time when a child comes into foster care, it's on an allegation of neglect. And that allegation of neglect often has to do with one of four main things: either deep poverty, so an inability to provide materially for the child, substance abuse, intimate partner violence, or mental health concerns. And so often those allegations of neglect are, you know, not necessarily things that are mean that a parent has not cared for their child the best they can. Often those parents have experienced a tremendous amount of trauma. And what should happen is that we as a system are providing those parents the support that they need so that they can care for their children. I think that the other really important thing to be aware of is that the system, there's a great deal of disproportionality in the foster care system. About 26% of the kids in New York City are Black, and nearly 60% of the kids in the foster care system are Black. So children are removed from their parents often for a number of reasons, but that in cases where if it was a middle-class white parent, they wouldn't necessarily be removed. So it's really important that we focus on that and focus on giving those families who are struggling, particularly during this pandemic, the resources that they need to keep their families safe and together.
I want you to share with us a little bit about doing some volunteer work as a volunteer advocate. That's what we started talking about. How are people actually can participate in becoming a volunteer advocate? Because I know that's something that you're looking for as well.
Absolutely. So if people are interested in becoming an advocate, it is a volunteer advocate with CASA is a serious commitment, first of all. You're required to go through 35 hours of training, and we ask you to make a two-year commitment. You can go on our website at CASA-NYC.org to fill out an application and learn more about the process. We are very fortunate at CASA NYC in that we have a lot of people stepping forward to be volunteers. And we actually, at this moment, have a number of people on a wait list because we have people volunteering faster than we can train them. However, we are really recruiting and targeting people who come from the communities that the people, the children and families we serve come from. So we're looking to recruit volunteers who are people of color, who come from the Bronx. I know we're talking to a largely Bronx audience, who come from communities where our families come from and who can relate to the children, relate to their circumstances, understand the challenges that they're facing, so they might be better able to help them through this process and help them find, those families find safety and stability.
Right. So you said it's about a 35-hour training?
It's 35 hours of training, yep.
And then you said, in addition to that, it's a two-year commitment.
Yes, we ask for a two-year commitment. And most importantly, we ask people to serve on a case for the life of the case. Typically, a volunteer is assigned to one or two cases at a time. But once you've established a relationship with a child or a family member, we don't want that person to go away. One of the biggest challenges in the child welfare system is turnover of caseworkers. So often the CASA volunteer is the person who is able to have the most long-term relationship with that child and with that family. And that's really important to give them a sense of stability.
Yeah. Well, you're making a difference. And thank you so much for the work that you're doing.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right. Glad to have you with us. Kerry Moles, our guest here on Open. I want you to stay with us. Listen, now, if you want more information, you can visit their website, CASANYC.org. Again, CASANYC.org. Also follow them on Facebook at CASANYC. Encourage you, please don't go anywhere. We still have more show. Open will return right after this.